Please subscribe to our channel by pressing the subscribe button and the bell icon to receive updates on new videos. So today's topic, how to become pure. In that today, I will be taking up what is a pure mind and how to attain that purity. What is a pure mind and how to attain that purity? So I'll be taking up these two topics today. The idea of purity, as we all know, is something that we all like. Everywhere this word purity is used as a good way to market a product. They say pure cotton, pure ghee, pure masala, pure silk. And the word that pure is there, everybody rushes. There's something that we like, it attracts the mind, the word pure. Because we are like, oh, we will not be cheated. That is one assurance. Whenever people use the word pure, the tag is there, we are like, oh, we will not be cheated. There's no adulteration in that. And everybody wants that sort of a thing, whatever it may be. That is why we rush towards that. We don't want anything mixed, we want it as it is. There must be a reason why we are all attracted to the word pure. Anywhere, anything is mentioned pure, our mind is pulled. There must be a reason for it. And the reason is very clear. The reason is that there is something our mind understands. What is purity? I like purity. And my mind also understands that I know what is impure, what is not clean. I know that also. Everybody knows that. But we search for it outside. And we try to get it also as much as possible. So even when you go and purchase a furniture, they'll be like, is this pure teak wood? So like that we'll all ask, is this pure? Is this clean? Is this unadulterated? So like this, just like there is in this world, the need for purity, there is also a need for purity in the internal world. And sadhakas, people who want God, when they go towards God, when they want to find out the truth, then the scriptures and the rishis and the teachers will tell, you need to have a pure mind. And then the aspirant, instead of God, first tries to make the mind pure. Because without purity, one cannot experience God, one cannot experience bliss. So his first attempt will be to make the mind pure, whatever happens. He doesn't know what it is. He'll go on searching. What is purity? Let me try. Let me make my mind pure. And even the, just like how advertisement is done in the outside world for pure ghee or pure cotton, like that even the teachers, the shastrakaras and avatars also advertise the word purity. They give purity nice terms and they make it very tempting for the sadhaka so that he might go for that purity. In the Gita also, the Lord says, Prashanta manasam henam yoginam sukhamuttamam upaiti shanta rajasam brahma bhutam akalmasham. So this is how even God advertises. He says, have a clean mind. And that mind which is clean, prashanta manasam, gets a peaceful mind. And that peaceful mind experiences sukham uttamam. Supreme bliss it experiences. And he says, that mind which is free, shanta rajasam, free from all passions, vigata kalmasham, kalmasha, which is impure, free from vigata, free from impurity. That mind which becomes free from impurity can experience supreme bliss. So when the sadhaka reads this, he's like, oh my God, this is what I need, and I need to get it. I will rush towards it. Natural. Again, Bhagavan says, Yunjan Nevam Sadatmanam Yogi Vigata Kalmashah. Again, he uses the word Vigata Kalmashah. And then he says, Sukhena Brahma Samsparsham Atyantam Sukham Ashnute. Again, another form of advertisement of bliss. Bhagavan is telling, Yunjan Nevam Sadatmanam Yogi, that yogi who's constantly engaged in meditating, but what? Whose mind is Vigata Kalmashah. Free from all taint, free from all impurity. Sukhena Brahma Samsparsham Atyantam. sukham ashnute. He goes on experiencing tremendous bliss, tremendous peace. Atyantam sukham ashnute. So see, these words are in the highest possible way expressing, trying to say how much bliss you can have. And this the scriptures speak like this. They say sukham atyantam ashnute. He goes on eating, drinking into it. But for what? Both the places where Bhagwan has told what you can get, he also told what you need. And he says akalmasha in the previous one and vigata kalmashaha in the second one. That it has to be, that is primary. So when an aspirant understands this, naturally his first inclination is, oh, sukha is there, atyantam, brahma bhutam, my mind will be merged in this infinite bliss, infinite source, but akalmashaha, vigata kalmashaha, I need my mind which is free from all taint, which is free from all stain. How do I get it? That is the first thing that an aspirant searches for, and he goes and tries to attain it. In the process of understanding what is a pure mind, we first try to search for it, and in the process we are not clear what exactly is purity. I can clean this book, it is pure again. I can clean this, so this harmonium, it becomes pure again according to my mind. So my house is very dirty, now it's very clean. The idea of clean is there as purity. That much I understand with the outside world. If I understand cotton, I realize that pure cotton has been taken and nothing has been added. No nylon, no polyester, nothing has been added. It is as it is, cotton. I understand. But when we go to the mind, how do we understand it? How do we understand what is a pure mind? This is something that everybody tries to grasp. Everybody tries to have an idea of. And it's very important to have the right idea so that we do not waste our time in running after things that are non-essential. First of all, before telling what is a pure mind, I will try to give you little examples, a few ideas of what is not a pure mind, which we think is a pure mind. People say that, oh, scientists have pure mind, thinkers have pure mind, musicians have pure mind. So the idea of pure mind is that which is not going towards sense object, that which is going towards higher things. That is not the pure mind we are talking of. The pure mind here that Bhagavan speaks of, the pure mind that we have come to understand is, what is that mind which will give us unending peace, bliss and fearlessness? That which will take us closer to God, that is our pure mind. So scientists and thinkers and poets, they might have a mind, but that mind is concentrated, not pure. That is not the word of purity that we use. It is definitely a concentrated mind. But what is but the thing is that a concentrated mind is required for everybody. Definitely. Everybody should cultivate a concentrated mind. Otherwise, a person can't even write something in peace. He can't read something peacefully. He can't drink a coffee peacefully if he does not have a peaceful mind, a concentrated mind. Everybody should have a concentrated mind. So is concentrated mind a pure mind? No. Concentration is definitely required, but concentrated mind is not a pure mind. Many scientists, even wicked men have concentrated minds. And what do? If they have to plot a terrorist attack, they do it with utmost precision, utmost concentration. Concentration is not a pure mind, but concentration is required for a pure mind. But it is not only that. Then, what is a pure mind? So, the Upanishads explain a bit of it. The Upanishads say, Upanishads have explained it completely, not a bit of it. We have to understand it fully by taking the words of the saints and sages. So, the Upanishads, Amrita Bindu Upanishad, says, Manohi dvividham proktam. Mind is said to be of two types. Shuddham cha, ashuddham eva cha. P pure and impure. Two types only the mind is. Pure and impure. Ashuddham kama sankalpam. What is ashuddham? What is impure mind? Kama sankalpa. That which has a lot of desires stored in the head. What sort of desires? Not desires stored in the head. Imagination. Tomorrow I'll become that. Tomorrow I need this. Tomorrow I want that object. Tomorrow this person should be my slave. Tomorrow that object should be my possession. This is kama sankalpa. And not just that. Not what will happen tomorrow. Even in the mind. Oh, this I did. This possession is mine. This is how he did this to me. I'm going to destroy him because he possessed that from me. He has got that. I'm going to get this. This is what had happened to me in the past. So this is kama sankalpa, past and future. So he says, ashuddham, Upanishad says, ashuddham kama sankalpam, shuddham kama vivarjitam. Shuddha mind, pure mind is free from that. Kama vivarjitam. Free from what? Very clear, free from imaginations. Free from thinking of something in the future that I will get. Free from what I have gained or lost in the past. It is free. They call it the pure mind. But the definition is there. It is to be understood. So suppose if somebody thinks like this, then definitely people merely having no kama sankalpa doesn't make our mind pure. Beggars don't have any kama sankalpa. They're happily sleeping in the streets. They have better sleep than us. That doesn't make their mind pure. When I say kama sankalpa, the Upanishads is very clear. I'm saying how we tend to understand. So I will not think about any desires in the future. I will not think about anything ahead. This is how we think. So this idea we have to understand, that merely having no kama sankalpa will give us that sort of a free and a pure mind. Then the Upanishads say, mana eva manushyanam karanam bandha mokshayoho bandhaya vishayasaktam muktam nirvishayam smritam. Mind is of two types, and mind alone is the reason for our bondage, and mind alone is the reason for our liberation. What is that mind? Bandhaya vishayasaktam, always wanting objects for the future. That is what we think is a bound mind, but it is not so. A bound mind is that, not merely which is asking only for vishayasaktam. Maybe in the, now we are not, we, many people say, no, I don't have any desires. I don't have anything in my mind. I'm okay with what I am. Then according to that, this must be the pure mind, but it is not the pure mind. Because we have deep inside our being, subconscious being, we have desires coming inside. Unless the subconscious and the conscious, both of them are equal, we cannot have a pure mind. So outside in my waking state, I might not have any sort of desires. But in my dream, when I'm sitting deep inside my heart, so many complexities are there. That will not make my mind pure. So that is one idea. That is not a pure mind. Simply vishayasakti is not there. That doesn't make a mind pure. There's something more that is required. So vishayasaktam is right. The Upanishad says is right. But we have to understand it rightly. So the mind cannot remain without thinking. Constantly it will be thinking. Constantly it will want something. You cannot leave the mind free. A free mind is not a great mind. A free mind is not a pure mind. People think that the pure mind idea is something like having no thoughts, free from any sort of ideas. It is not so. It is not like that. Some people think when we have no thoughts, suddenly, oh, my mind is very calm, I'm very relaxed. No, then the next second, immediately thoughts come into the mind and we are pulled. That also doesn't give us a pure mind. Then is the last, which most of us make a mistake of thinking is a pure mind. And that is external purity. We think that if I take a bath, I'll be pure. If I have pure habits, good habits, I'm pure. It is definitely necessary, but it is not meant to make the body pure. The body pure doesn't make the mind pure at all. It is only for us to tell our mind that I am pure that we take bath. Because if you take bath, within few minutes you will sweat. Again, it will be impure. And how can the body become pure? Body is full of filth, full of blood, pus, everything. It can never be pure. This is what Sri Ramakrishna says. It can never be pure. So there was once a person who had the desire for something. And he went to a priest and he told the priest, I have this desire, please fulfill it. Can we fulfill it? So the priest told, yes, you can fulfill it. Ensure everything is pure. If everything is pure, tomorrow you do this puja and ensure everything is pure. If everything is pure, your desire will be fulfilled. So this person got all the articles for the worship. He went to the priest. So his mind was only thinking, oh, is my body pure? He took good bath. Are my nails clean? He cut it. And then he saw all the products that I have bought, my agarbatti, is it pure? Is it not the chemical one? No, it is pure. It is sandalwood. My flowers, is it organic or inorganic? It is organic. Everything is pure. He got them. He got cotton deepas. He got pure ghee. And he put it in front of the priest. And the priest asked, is everything pure? He said, yes, everything is pure. Then his mind was thinking, everything is pure. Again, he's not sure. Is everything pure? Have I done everything pure? And then the pujari goes and he worships the Lord. As he worships the Lord, he sees that on the Lord there is mukuta, there is ornaments, everything is there. Then suddenly he's like, the priest told me everything should be pure. Is that gold on the Lord pure? If that is not pure, my prayer might not be fulfilled. Is that metal image of the Lord of pure copper? Or is it mixed with other metals? Is that Bhatru pure? Is that priest pure? Has he taken bath? All these things come. And then he asks the priests. And the priest, and he tells, priest, I had this doubt, everything, my mind was going on running behind purity and I started doubting if everything is pure. Because you told everything should be pure. And I started thinking everything is pure. I got everything that is pure. I thought even whatever I did is pure. But the second you started worshipping the God, I want to know, is that gold pure? Is that murti pure? And the Bhatru says, when I said everything is pure, I meant to tell you, is your mind pure? That is the most important thing. It is not about the externals. If we go on thinking, is this pure, is this pure, the mind becomes only restless. It never sits quiet. So this is what Krishna says also in the Gita. Krishna says, if the mind is not focused, there can never be purity. He says, Vyavasayatmika buddhi samadhau navidhiyate. Mind is not determined on one particular thing. It is running behind this purity, that purity. External purity is not purity. Sri Ramakrishna says, you can go into the Ganga. People go into the Ganga to remove their sins. He says, but it is like that the sins will sit on the tree when you go inside the Ganga, because Ganga cannot take impurity. So the sins will sit there. Second, you come out from the Ganga, the sins will jump on your back again. That is the idea of purity that we have. So Sri Ramakrishna says, no, that will not work. Then what is the idea of purity? Here, Paramanandaji gives us what exactly is a pure mind. He says, mind is impure when it is divided and lacking in viveka. Viveka is important. It is pure and clean when it is single. For purity means singleness. So we told it is not merely a concentrated mind, it should be also not merely a concentrated mind, it should even have discrimination. But focus is very important. Mind should be one-pointed, not free mind, one-pointed mind. And it should have discrimination. What discrimination? discrimination that this world that I am grabbing will never give me happiness. It will make me only restless. It will make me only empty. And the only way I can have this sort of peace and joy is in the Supreme Being inside. This is Viveka. Merely having Viveka is of no use. Mind also should be concentrated. Most of us have Viveka. So there are two conditions for a pure mind. One is it should be concentrated. The other is it should have Viveka. This is a pure mind. Now, what is the nature of this pure mind? The pure mind, we told, has to have discrimination and concentration. But most of us have discrimination, but when it comes to concentration on God, we have no concentration. Why is it that we have no concentration? It's because our minds are attached. We have already realized we are deeply attached or we are deeply bound. We can't think of God, we can't understand Him, we can't put our mind on Him. We understand everything is unreal, but when it comes to focus and meditation, we don't have that power. Then what are we supposed to do? In fact, in our lives we see very few rare souls, when they are born itself, they have concentration and love for God also. But most of us have Viveka, but we don't have concentration on God. In fact, when we have Viveka, we realize we are deeply attached to somebody in this world. Family, children, wife, house, we are deeply attached. Money. But we realize, oh, it will not give me happiness. Now we want God. Where will the mind go towards God? It will not go. Then we are stuck. There are some who are not deeply attached, but they're deeply committed in the world. They have their commitments of family, wife, children, everything. How can such a mind which is so busy, so caught up, how can that go towards God? When we meditate, not even for more than 2 minutes can our mind go towards God. But to have a pure mind, the Shastras say, the mind should rush towards God. The Shankaracharya says, Taila Dharavat Samana Pratyaya Pravahena Dirga Kalam. That is called Dhyanam. Only then we can have a pure mind. Taila Dharavat, like how oil is poured, continuous. Samana Pratyaya, one thought, constant, not divided, one thought, like how the oil is poured. And it should have continuous flow towards that for a long time. Where is it? So you see, we are all stuck and it is difficult. How do we do it? And for that, Sri Ramakrishna has a solution. Sri Ramakrishna gives two kinds of answers for two kinds of people. Some of us have Viveka, but we're deeply attached. For them, he says, that same attachment which you have, the force which you have, when you close your eyes, if I'm attached to my children or wife or family, their form comes to my mind. Sri Ramakrishna says, in the place of that form where that attachment power is rushing, think of the Lord. Think of your Rishta. And that same force, put it on Him. Convert the form of your beloved relative or anybody into that form of the Lord and let that force go towards. Nobody can say, no, I'll not think of my relative, I'll think of God. It'll never happen. That same force has to go towards that only. This is Sri Ramakrishna's solution. Sri Ramakrishna says that love which a man has for his wealth, which a husband has for a chaste wife, and which a mother has for a child, that force, when it is combined, a person can meditate on God. But it has to be directed towards God, the Ishta. This is for people who are deeply attached. Then he gives a solution for people who are not deeply attached, but they're deeply committed. They have their commitments, they can't come out. They have understood Viveka, but they can't realize God. They can't go into solitude, they can't go into the forest. What do such people do? For that also, Sri Ramakrishna has a solution. And he says, let such people who have developed Viveka, but are caught up in their commitments, let them work like a housemaid works in a house. The housemaid does all her work in her master's house, but her mind is on her child. She will say to the owner's child, she'll say, this is my Hari, I will take care of you, I'll give you bath, but her mind is on her child. So Sri Ramakrishna says, people who are committed, let them do their work diligently, complete their commitments fully, have total dedication, thinking that they are serving the children of God and that their real goal is to go towards Him in the end. If both these techniques are adopted, then Viveka is already there, Dhyanam comes very naturally. But remember, as soon as it is told, it is not attained. It has to be done through steady practice. And through steady practice, day in, day out, a mind like that is attained. And many people, this is not only Sri Ramakrishna, even Sri Ramakrishna's disciples have given these techniques to their disciples, and people have benefited largely. Because the Upanishads say free mind. Where do we have a free mind? Upanishads say concentrated mind on God. We don't have it. Avatars give us the solution, and this is that solution. Gradually, Sri Ramakrishna says, how when you put a thread to a needle, fiber should not stick out, it should be pointed. One point. Gradually we have to make it one point and then it goes towards God. And that meditation is gradual. Gradual. Today we might have 5 minutes of that meditation. After 1 month we might have 10 minutes of that meditation. But that 10 minutes, when we are able to think continuously of God, the mind becomes pure. So the pure mind is not a free mind. A pure mind is a highly concentrated mind. And that highly concentrated mind with Viveka going towards the supreme truth. Jnanis will call it Atman. Bhaktas will call it God. It is the same thing. The Bhakta will think that that Atman has come as the form of the Ishta and force its mind towards there. In the end, it should go inside. This is the solution. This is what a pure mind is. A pure mind is two, once again. A concentrated mind with Viveka, concentrated on what? On God, on the highest truth. Not a thoughtless mind, fully concentrated, undivided, single, forceful thought. That is what is called a pure mind. And Sri Krishna gives us that assurance also. He says that definitely a person, in whatever way of life he is, he will get that truth if he meditates on these two methods which Sri Ramakrishna has explained. He says, Sarva Bhuta Stitam Yo Mam Bhajat Yekatva Mastitaha Sarvatha Vartamanopi Sayogi Mai Vartate. He who is established in unity worships me, who am dwelling in all beings. So our loved ones, our dear ones, we try to see the God in them. And he says, Sarvatha. Whatever be his life, not just a yogi sitting in the forest, any place, if this attitude is practiced of diverting your energies towards God, he says that that yogi will always come to me alone. So that is the idea of a pure mind. So the pure mind can be practiced anywhere, even if we are in samsara. But the idea is that if you are deeply attached, that attachment should take the form of a rishta and go towards him. And if we are deeply committed, we should think of ourselves, as Sri Ramakrishna said, the housemaid. We are here to do our work to the best of our abilities, but my house is elsewhere, that is in God. And one day I will go there only, and then I will continue doing my duties. So these are the few ideas on what is a pure mind and how to attain it.